بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household and all his companions. May Allah bless them and may he bless every single one of us. My brothers and sisters in Islam, every one of us should be having a stock of good deeds. We should be having perhaps a number of good deeds that we've done that we can be holding with us, so that on the day of Qiyamah we would be having something to place on the right side of the scale. And I'm convinced that every one of us has engaged in good deeds and continues to engage in whatever good deeds possible. So that is a good note. It is something really encouraging. However, it is important for us to get the best deal, isn't it? Every time we have something we want to buy and purchase, if it costs, especially now in this country, for example, things are quite expensive, it would be worth your while to shop around and to make sure that the deal you're getting is worth it. It would be foolish for you to buy something for $2 somewhere and find it elsewhere for 80 cents. And you would actually want to smack yourself. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So, similarly, we have something that we find in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that tells us what the best deals are when it comes to your deeds. Because I like to read my salah, I like to, for example, do so much that I can, and I'm sure we all are the same. Whatever is made easy for us, we do in terms of good. But when is it that I will get the most out of my deeds? So inshallah, we will spend the next few minutes talking about this. Point number one, we do things for the sake of Allah without wanting a reward from humankind. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Dahr, إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا. Allah says, we feed you, speaking about feeding the poor, those who are good and close to Allah, who want the best deal, they say, we are feeding you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From you, we don't need anything. We don't even want a statement of thanks. All we need is for Allah to accept it. So this shows us sincerity of intention. When we do a good deed, we give out a charity, we give money, we donate something, we help out somewhere. Never do it in order to get a chip on your shoulder or to be acknowledged from humankind. If they do say thank you, jazakallah khair, they make a dua for you, it's their goodness. But don't ever request it from them to say, you know what, I did this for you one day and this is, and you forgot about it. If that is the case, then did you do it for them to remember, or did you do it for the sake of Allah? So you will have a deal, but it won't be as fruitful as if you had done it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those whom, when we do good, we would expect a reward from Allah and Allah alone. Ameen. Secondly, when we do a deed, it's important for us to try our best to hide the deed. Allahu Akbar. Now one might say, what do you mean? What this means is, sometimes we do know it's encouraging when we have the intention of encouraging others to do a deed that others would know. Like for example, if here we are collecting money for a good cause, a very good cause, and someone would, or we are to announce in public, brothers and sisters, put up your hands and donate something. And a man says, I donate $5. And the man next to him says, I donate $10. The intention should be that I am saying it aloud so that others can actually compete with me in goodness. That is permissible. Did you hear what we've just said? It's permissible if you are doing it with the intention that, look, I'd like others to compete with me in goodness. And this is shown by the action of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made an open announcement for donations, they came in with certain percentage, the other one came in with more, and they looked at each other and said, now this one will not be able to come with more than I will. And then the other one, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, came with everything he had. And this was the competition that they had. It was for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ta'ala. No contamination in that. But sometimes we may publicize it if it is for the right reasons. However, when it is not necessary to publicize it, let it be between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brother, I donated this. It's from an anonymous brother. Allahu Akbar. Or anonymous sister has done this. If possible, it would give you a better deal. You would get better returns for that investment. Allahu Akbar. Because you have done it solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we say hide your deed, we learn from this that when you are fulfilling voluntary prayer, it is best to do it at home. This is the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Your farad, you read in the masjid. And obviously, if you're a person who's weak, you and I would want to read our sunnah and etc. etc. in the masjid as well. Because perhaps if we left and we left it, we would not even read it. So it's better in those cases to make sure you read it in the masjid. But the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaks of how important it is to liven up the home by engaging in voluntary acts of salah or voluntary acts of worship, like reading of the Quran and so on within the home. So that number one is you liven up the home. The angels of mercy, the angels that come with the blessings would actually be around the home and surrounding, and the blessings would be descending, and it would be a better deal for you. So much so that the Prophet ﷺ speaks of salatul tahajjud. You know, tahajjud is in the early hours of the morning, or the last third of the night, as it would be. In that particular salah, the best thing to do is to read your prayer whilst the others are asleep. Get up in a way that you haven't disturbed anyone. It's a voluntary prayer, unless your spouse or children or someone, parents, have told you to get them up because they would like to fulfill the salah. The best deal you could get is to do it in a silent manner. No one knows you got up. No one knows you made your wudu. No one knows you fulfill salah, because that can only be for the sake of Allah. So this is what we mean when we say hide your deed. When you hide your deed, there is a better deal that you struck with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, when I'm reading my Quran, I may do so. There's nothing wrong. I can do it in the masjid. I can read it here. I can do my deeds. But I would get a better deal if I were to do it silently, quietly, without anyone watching. And that would be the best for me. May Allah make it easy for us to do that. Another brilliant deal that is mentioned in more than one hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is when you do something regularly, even if it is very little. So in Islam, a better deal than doing something big once would be to do small things on a regular basis. That is it. So if I'm very kind and generous and one day I donate $100 to a good cause, obviously the figure would differ depending on the size of your pocket, mashallah. But if I made a big donation one day and then I forgot about it for the rest of the year, it would be better for me to donate on a regular basis something that would continue. And there are reasons for this. You never know the time of acceptance. The time of acceptance of your dua perhaps. Or the time when the multiplication of your good deed is. Sometimes you do a deed. For example, I might do a deed in Ramadan. In Ramadan it's multiplied. We definitely know this. If I fast, for example, on the 10th of Muharram and the 9th with it, or the 11th with it, the reward is far greater than if I were to just fast on an ordinary day. But it is a sunnah to fast on a Monday and a Thursday. We don't deny that. But I'm only making mention to you that some days are higher than others. So if you were to do it regularly, it would coincide at some time with a moment of greatness. And perhaps you'd just be, as we would term it, accepted in that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant acceptance. So when we do a deed of goodness, let's continually do it. There is no point in getting up for tahajjud and reading long, long raka'at, but only once in your life. Try and make it regular, even if it is once a week, but let it be once a week. If it is once a month, let it be once a month. Let's hope that it becomes every day, inshallah. Why not? But if you do something regularly, it shows responsibility, it shows dedication, and it shows that by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you are a person who would like to see improvement and growth in that particular aspect. If I'm a person who doesn't want to see growth, for example, in a certain aspect of my spiritual life, my religious life, for example, I will come for Salatul Jum'ah and that's it. And I wait for the next Jum'ah. But if I come for Jum'ah and the next time I make sure that I've come a little bit earlier, I've improved. I'm showing that I want growth. And this brings us to the next point. If you want the best deal, not only should you continuously do a deed, but you should think of ways of improving and start implementing. I give you an example of a sister who is, mashallah, starting to dress more appropriately. So, mashallah, when she comes to the masjid or when she goes for an Islamic program or when she goes, you know, to visit at the funeral home, etc., etc., you find she's covered properly. In her heart should be that I want this to be maintained throughout my life. I don't want it just to be an occasional correct dressing. I want it to be so correct that the day I die, no matter where I am, but I will be dressed correctly and I will have earned the pleasure of Allah, because Allah knows my struggle with my own clothing. And this is why we are not allowed to judge people. When we say judge, we mean passing a judgment to say this man is bad, this woman is bad, because we don't know how the condition will be the day they end. And we don't know our condition the day we will end. So this is why it's of absolute and utmost importance for us to worry about ourselves. And this is another deal that would be really, really great. When we are concerned more about ourselves than others, and the concern we have for others should only be a positive concern, not a negative concern. For example, if you see someone with a bottle, a beer bottle, for example, a true Muslim who wants the best deal out of it will firstly make a dua for the person, pray for them. And a person who's going to lose the deal is one who quickly tweets about it and puts it on WhatsApp and takes a picture without the person knowing that this person's with the bottle and wants to disgrace them on Facebook and everywhere else. What would happen? Not only would we lose a deal, but we would actually suffer a loss. However, we want to solve the problem. We will make a dua for the individual. We will continue. We will try our best. And we will perhaps speak to them in a beautiful, direct manner. Brother, you know, 2 days ago I saw you. And he'll tell you, I don't even start. You know, like I was giving an example. Once, some years back, I saw a brother with a bottle in his hand. And you know, when I say bottle, what we're talking about. So when I looked at him and I asked him a question, or in fact, even before that, he tells me, hey, do you think there's alcohol in here? No, I use this for water. I said, okay, brother, don't worry. It's okay, it's fine. Because the message got across and the respect was there, and he knew that what he was doing was wrong. But alhamdulillah, the same brother, mashallah, he perhaps, I'd like to hope, has quit it completely, because we've never ever seen that, and it's not up to us. He doesn't owe that deed to me or you. He owes it to Allah. Remember this. He does not owe it to me or you. He owes it to Allah. So do not become a person who wants to play the role of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to condemn people and to bring them closer, thinking that it's your duty and responsibility. No. Your duty, my duty, is to encourage people in a positive way. So to strike the best deal, we would need to be worried about our own weakness. When we see that, look, someone else is engaged in a weakness, we can or we should contribute positively to try and help them, but it must humble us to think, what about my own weakness? And for your information, there is no human being that does not have a weakness. No human being. But the level of the weakness differs from person to person. That doesn't make you a saint, nor does it make you a person who's totally condemned, because all it takes from a person who's been engaged in bad behavior is to repent to Allah, to turn to Him. And guess what? His sins are wiped out. This is how easy it is. And all it takes from a person who's been on the right path to become deviated is to slip once and to fall into the trap of the devil. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. Really, may He make us from those whom, when we do good deeds, it humbles us. That is also another way of striking the best deal. When you've done something good, you came for salah early, and you're sitting, for example, in the first saf. You know, sometimes what happens to us, mashallah, this masjid, the first saf, you really have to be in competition to get into it, because you know, it's not as long as perhaps other places. However, a person who comes very, very early and they make it to the first saf, alhamdulillah, it will humble them if they have the correct intentions. They feel that, you know, Allah has blessed me. A person who comes early for salah, they fulfill it correctly. They sit thereafter, they engage in their adhkar. They do good deeds. They have, mashallah, tried their best to read one page of the Quran every single day. Like we said moments ago, even if it is just a page, make sure it's every day. Don't just come and read one whole juz a day, and the next time you see the Quran is the next year. Read a page a day, even half a page a day, a verse a day, but it is regular. That is more loved to Allah than something that is only done once in a blue moon. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So the deal we're talking about here is when your good deed makes you humble, down to earth. You look at other people, you talk to them with utmost respect. You have that respect of others, even though you might know that on specific aspects they may have weaknesses, but you speak to them with utmost respect as though they are your bigger brother, or as though they are people who are far more in their closeness with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than you are. This is how you strike a deal. But the minute shaitan gets grip of someone, how do you know that shaitan gets grip of you? When you're doing good deeds, when you start feeling, no, I'm the one doing the good deeds. As for all these other guys, they are by the way. The minute you start thinking others are by the way, you need to now know shaitan has got you properly gripped and your deal is no way profitable. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us deals that are profitable. And this is why the environment in the house of Allah and the masjid should be such that people want to come. They should feel respected and honored. They should be people who we should be contributing towards making the environment such that people feel like they want to come to the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why another deal, you want to strike the best deal out of your attendance in the masjid, make sure when you come into the masjid, all your dealings are left outside the gate. You need to make sure. Everything to do with your dealing outside the gate. You have a problem with an individual, it's outside the gate. You come into the masjid, that's it. It's you, it's Allah, and it's the goodness of the worshippers who have come for the sake of Allah. Simple reason, it's not your house. Nor is it mine. Nor does it belong to anyone. It belongs to Allah. You, it's your duty to ensure that the guests who've come for the sake of Allah to His house, you make them feel wanted. You make them feel comfortable. You welcome them. You greet them with a smile. And if you do have a problem, perhaps it's your opportunity to resolve it in a way that would achieve everlasting peace between the two. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us solve and resolve our matters and problems and disputes that we may have between us. So this is the house of Allah. You want the best deal? Come in for salah with a good heart. And this is why we say, when getting up for salah and when straightening the rows, you know it's important to make an announcement following the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to straighten the rows, to ensure the shoulders are all touching one another's, the rows are filled, the first and then the next. You don't leave a gap for the devil. It is said that if there is a gap, the devil comes in between the two people. And this is why the proper way of fulfilling the saf is to be such, today we would call it, I'm slightly squashed. That's what we would say. I'm feeling slightly squashed because someone's shoulders on mine and the other one's on mine and the other one's on his. That is the proper sunnah. The proper way of standing in the saf is that the shoulders are touching one another's. That shows, that is the proper way. The Prophet ﷺ used to spend time, really. He used to spend time going through the saf, through the rows, in order to make sure the heels are all in a line, the shoulders are touching one another's, nobody standing in front and, you know, messing the line and so on. Because he used to say, وَلَا تَخْتَلِفُوا فَتَخْتَلِفَ قُلُوبُكُمْ. Do not be jagged because your hearts will become jagged. Imagine. You stand in a line, you're showing love, you're showing the feeling, you are my brother. In the case of the sisters, you are the sister indeed. And this is why it will be straight, no matter who you are. I could have had an issue with you and so on. The fact is, we all come to the masjid on a specific level of purity and cleanliness. We've all washed our hands, our feet. No one can say, I'm smelling, this one is smelling. In fact, if a person has eaten something offensive, like onion or something of that nature, it is a sunnah that before you come to the house of Allah, wash your mouth properly so that the people next to you don't have to move away. Because now if someone says, why isn't your shoulder touching his? He might say, hey brother, you know what? This guy's eaten onions. May Allah protect us. To protect us from this, the Prophet ﷺ clearly says, if you've eaten onion or raw garlic and so on, mouth has a stench, wash it before you come in. We would add to the list cigarettes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us clean mouths. May Allah make us such that we can actually wash before we come to talk to Him, to communicate with Him. Ameen. So as we enter the house of Allah, we have this announcement that is made to say, straighten the rows. Why? Because if you don't, yes, your farad is done, but the greater achievement of that salah is not there. And this is why sometimes we would hear an imam say, cleanse the heart. Wow. Cleanse the heart before you start your prayer, because indeed that prayer which is the best deal is that wherein your heart is as clean as possible. What's the point of me saying Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest, and I'm going down in prostration for Him, but my heart is full of jealousy, malice, hatred. The brother who's next to me, that's who the problem is with. Allahu Akbar. So I need to clean my heart. I need to understand how temporary this dunya is, this life is, if I would like to achieve the best deal from my salah. And I need to fulfill salah in a way that I am convinced that it might just be my last salah. That's the best deal when it comes to prayer. Salli salata muwaddain. The hadith says, and I am adding to this to say, if you'd like to strike the best deal, but the hadith, the wording of it is, when you fulfill your salah, fulfill it as though it is the last opportunity you're going to have to pray for the sake of Allah. And wallahi, if you do that, wouldn't you have the best deal? Forget about the whole world. Take your time. These are just a few pointers that I've made mention of how to strike the best deal when it comes to various deeds. May Allah grant us sincerity and open our doors. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad.